Welcome friends to this module on adapting, using and sharing open education resources. In the previous modules, you got the understanding of what are open education resources. You understood various types of Creative Commons licenses. You also got an idea on how to search OER and various repositories of OER. As a teacher, we need to create courses. For creating courses, we need content materials, which can be in different formats like text, audio, video, animation, graphics, simulations, etc. OER are beneficial to us as a learner too. There are many researches which show cost savings when learners use open textbooks for learning purpose. One of the fundamental practice with OER is that there is no need to reinvent the wheel. There are billions of open resources available to us, and therefore, when we create a course, we must use and adapt what is available to us already. So, in this module, we shall learn about adapting, using, and sharing open educational resources. So, when you complete this module, you would be able to identify examples of different open licenses, adapt open education resources for teaching learning purpose, use OER for teaching, learning and research, and share the open resources which you may be creating it. Now, let us think. Are you interested in sharing your material? Do you have an engaging course activity, image, assessment, item or video, or a whole course that might be beneficial to your fellow faculty members? If yes, then consider releasing them as an OER. How we can release them as an OER? Let's see. First, we need to understand the terms of use. We need to decide on them. Do we wish to release our work under Creative Commons license or in the public domain? Please make sure to review the difference between these two copyright terms. By releasing your work under a Creative Commons license, you retain ownership while allowing others to use your work as long as they attribute it to you without needing to ask permission of you directly. By releasing your work in the public domain, your copyright ownership is waived. It is as if you are giving your work to the public as a gift. Users may still cite you when adopting your work, but they are not required to do so. Then next, we seek copyright clearance. Be sure that the work is eligible to be shared. In order to release your work with a Creative Commons license or in the public domain, your work should be cleared from all copyright issues. To do so, your work should be one or a combination of the following types, like your original work, built from open resources, built from public domain, built from copyrighted work that you obtained permission to use, or a combination of these. Now, you should bear in mind that for any third-party materials, whether openly licensed or copyrighted, these materials need to be attributed as not governed by Creative Commons license you choose for your work, but under different terms and by different authors. Now, how to give permission to use copyright materials? If you must use any item that are copyrighted with all rights reserved, please be sure to obtain the permission letter from the authors. Okay, I would like to give you an advice as a reminder. Creative Commons licenses are non-revocable. This means that you cannot stop someone who has obtained your work under a Creative Commons license from using the work according to that license. You can stop offering your work under a Creative Commons license at any time you wish, but this will not affect the rights associated with any copies of your work already in circulation under a Creative Commons license. So you need to think carefully when choosing a Creative Commons license to make sure that you are happy with people being able to use your work consistent with the terms of license, even if you later stop distributing your work. So, the text for the considerations for licensors and licenses by Creative Commons, that is CC BY. Let us see some of the example cases of Creative Commons licenses understanding how we can adapt open educational resources. The one example is Public Library of Science. Now, as Wikipedia has defined it, The PLOS is a non-profit open access science, technology and medicine publisher with a library of open access journals and other scientific literature under an open content license. It launched its first journal, PLOS Biology, in October 2003, and it applies Creative Commons Attribution, that is CC BY license, to work it publishes. This license was developed to facilitate open access, namely free immediate access to and unrestricted use of original works of all types. Under this license, authors agree to make articles legally available for use without permission or fees for virtually any purpose. Anyone may copy, distribute, reuse these articles as long as the author and the original source are properly cited. Second example is Sailor Academy. It is also a non-profit initiative working since 2008 to offer free and open online courses to all who want to learn. It offers nearly 100 full-length courses at the college and professional level, each of which is available right now at your pace, on your schedule, and free of cost. Its learning materials are curated from a trove of free and open online resources by subject experts. The Sailor Academy focuses on designing a self-paced learning experience that comes as close as possible to what you would learn in a college classroom. Its certificates are free and the courses are available to you anytime, and the deadlines are under your control. Excluding course final exam, content authored by Sailor Academy is available under a Creative Commons Attribution Unported license. And you may be using it already many times, the biggest online encyclopedia, the Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a free online encyclopedia created and edited by volunteers around the world and hosted by the Wikimedia Foundation. The content on Wikipedia pages is available under Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike license. Now let's have a look at an example for publishing CC BY NC-ND, that is non-commercial, non-derivative. An example is by Wiley, which publishes research under open access Creative Commons license on its platform, and these materials, they can be posted on like ResearchGit as long as the Creative Commons license is observed and remains in place. Another example is TED Talks. The goal of TED is to spread ideas. They encourage the TED community, non-profit organizations, bloggers, companies, new medias, and the like to share TED Talks that are open for distribution through social media, other platforms, and public events. While sharing ideas openly is a big part of who they are, they do license its content under certain conditions. They encourage you to share TED Talks that are licensed for distribution under Creative Commons license attribution, non-commercial, non-derivative, which means it may be shared by following a few requirements. Certain TED Talks that are licensed to TED, such as performances and or other talks that we have shared but not created, may not be distributed. Let's see an example of another license, which is CC BY NC-SA, that is non-commercial share alike. And good example is MIT OpenCourseWare, which is a web-based publication of virtually all MIT course content. The OpenCourseWare is open and available to the world and is a permanent MIT activity. MIT OpenCourseWare makes the materials used in the teaching of almost all MIT subjects available on the web free of charge. With more than 2,400 courses available, this is delivering on the promise of open sharing of knowledge. So after having the understanding of these various kind of licenses as are being used by organizations or people, let us see the ways to integrate OER into our own content. And for that, there are various ways in which we can integrate them in our content. Say, like, we can modify or revise existing OER depending on CC license. We can embed the entire OER in our course, or we can embed a relevant portion of OER in our course, or we can provide hyperlink also to use it. There are some reasons to adopt an existing OER, like the University, Queen's University Library. It suggests that we can consider any modifications we may need to make to the content to ensure it is appropriate for our own course learning outcomes, assessment approaches, as well as our teaching style. For example, you may wish to add or delete, reorder or remix the existing content. This is a reason to modify an existing work that appeared in the article that Why Mix an Open Educational Resource by Liam Greenhuges. They suggested that adapt the material to make it more accessible for people with different disabilities. We need to insert cultural specific references to make a concept easier to understand. We may need to translate it into any other language. We may correct any error or inaccuracy which is in the original work. We need to update the book to add the latest research, discoveries or theories. We may like to insert more media or links to other resources and materials available. We may adapt a material for a different audience or a different level, and we may adapt it for different teaching situations. So there are various steps by following which we can adapt OER for our own courses. So what we need to do is, say, step one, assess the validity and reliability of the OER. The Queen's University Library of Canada suggests that as you find existing openly licensed content which you would like to adapt to integrate into your own course, consider the following review criteria. The first is permission. Do you have copyright permission to adapt and reuse the resource you wish? And before reusing the content, check the license details and exact terms of reuse to see if there are any restrictions on modifying the resource to create something new. Then the OER may be licensed under one of the 6 Creative Commons licenses. Find that. Apply best practices for attributing Creative Commons materials. The second is appropriateness or relevance. Is the content appropriate to your audience? Maybe it is suitable for first year or second year, or experience or expertise of your students or your audience, like that. The another criteria is the clarity, comprehensibility or readability of the material. Is the content you have selected is clear or comprehensible? Is it well organized, like about its logic, sequencing and flow? Then we need to check the consistency or the accuracy of the material. Does the resource use consistent language or terminology? Is the content accurate, error-free and unbiased? Is it free from factual, grammatical or typographical errors? We need to see adaptability or modularity. Is the resource in a file format which allows for adaptations, modifications, rearrangements and updates? Can the resource be easily divided into bit-sized pieces which can be remixed or reordered? And production quality, very important. Is the information clear and understandable? Is the layout and interface easy to navigate? Do the design features enhance learning? And when you use audio or video resources, is the sound quality high? Are there broken links or obsolete formats if you use any online resource? Then, next parameter is interactivity. We need to see, does the resource encourage active learning or class participation? Are there opportunities for students to test their understanding of the material? For example, a video with embedded questions. Then we need to pay attention to interface. The text is free of significant interface issues, including navigation problems, distortion of images, charts, or any other display feature which may distract or confuse the reader. And equally important, cultural relevance. We need to see that the text is not culturally insensitive or offensive in any way. It should make use of examples that are inclusive of variety of races, ethnicities, and backgrounds. we need to pay attention to accessibility also. Is the content accessible to students with disabilities? Is it Disability Act compliant? For example, do the images have alternate text that can be read? Do the videos have accurate closed captioning? Are students able to access the materials in a quick, non-restrictive manner? After that, second step. Determine the placement of the content with the curriculum, if you have not done it already. And note that some OER integration may not be useful at this point if the OER relates poorly to the rest of the curriculum. The next step is to check the license compatibility. Now, I'll tell you a very interesting web resource as the CC Mixer. You can see it on the screen now, that when this site lets you select openly licensed content, and then you can check that whether it will mix or not. So you can select certain kind of licenses and click on when to find it whether mix or not. Then it will tell you whether the mixing is possible or the mixing will fail. That you can check this resource. It's very good resource for finding out the mixing of resources. The next step is to remove irrelevant content within the identified OER. And be aware that you need to assume that the license permits this derivative. The next step is to identify localization. Why do we need localization? It is needed if it needs some translation, modifying the formats of, say, like dates or currencies, and recontextualizing the OER to be more meaningful for the learners in a local context. The next step is then remixing with other educational materials. And then finally, we need to devise a method of evaluation. We need to consider certain issues. For example, is the content class appropriate? Will students have enough information to meet the objectives? What are the technical requirements? For example, both the hardware and software for the localization or remix. Is there sufficient time for me as a teacher for the adaptation? And there are certain rubrics available which can be used. One of them is LORI rubric, that is Learning Object Review Instrument, which has the following parameters, which are evaluated on a scale of 1 to 5, as you can see on the screen. The another rubric is Achieve. Here we rate the parameters, as you can see on the screen, on a scale of 1 to 3. The good point about this rubric is it focuses on single units of a content. After this, now let us see an example of integration of content in an open course. This is the website of OpenStax. Here you can see in the image, in this unit, an image has been integrated with proper citation. Similarly, another resource has been integrated in the form of an image and a video link. Below that image, you can see from there, the video link is provided. So that is the integration. In a way, once you integrate the material, then we need to share our material, our OER. So once you have adapted and integrated an open educational resource to your content, you can share it using various platforms like OER Commons, or your learning management system, or your blog, etc. But be careful, you need to assign proper license to your content. Finally, at the end, I would like to suggest that adopting OER to our content provides an excellent opportunity to enrich our content with our other quality resources available. So we should be aware of how we can mix or revise the content with an already existing open license. Thank you very much.